So today, let me just introduce myself before going into the session. So I am Shri Priya here. I am a corporate training specialist and I have got 14 plus years of experience in training. I have conducted various training sessions in Sapien, Harman, State Street, HP, and you can just see the corporate names. I have trained 1,000 plus freshers in Java full stack. And for experienced guys, I have trained in Spring and Spring microservices, especially in State Street, Society General, and also in Harman. So my expertise is in full stack Java training. So actually, what is the agenda for today? I'll just tell you, what are the key takeaways from my Spring microservice course? What is the course details? And we will see what is a microservice and what are the components that actually we will be seeing in this training. Now, to start with, like, let me just tell you what are the key takeaways after you complete this microservice training. You will be competent enough to develop microservice applications using Spring Boot and Netflix OSS. When I say Netflix OSS, it is an open source system. Whatever components you need for developing a microservice, it is available for free. And with the help of that, you will understand the components which are needed, especially for fault tolerance, service discovery, then API gateway, Hystrics. See, based on my interaction with the fellow corporate people in different working in corporates, when I go there, we usually do with Netflix OSS. But usually in every corporate, they have their own way of working with service discovery. But the concept is same. Zool API gateway, how microservices interact, all these are same, but they have their own internally developed the discovery servers, their own fault tolerance, all these are available. Okay. Now, in Netflix OSS stack, as I told you, these are few components which are available. So that also you will be learning. And of course, you will be creating an end-to-end application. And you will learn how to deploy it in PCF, Pivotal Cloud Foundry. Now, these are the key takeaways. And now let me just tell you what are the course contents actually we will see. So I hope you can see my Word document. So to start with, we will be learning why we need microservices and what are the disadvantages of a monolithic architecture. Just a second, I'm getting a question. I will just check that. Okay. Thank you. So, these are the topics that I will be dealing in Spring microservices. First, you will understand what are the disadvantages of microservices. What is a microservice? Little bit of design patterns and the characteristics of microservice. So these are the theoretical part. Few people who would have worked with Spring Boot, few will not have worked with Spring Boot. So for them, we'll be having few sessions on Spring Boot, especially working with Data JPA. So it will be like an end-to-end application. Once you have completed this, then we will be going in for Netflix OSS. In Netflix OSS, it has got its own components, way of working with Spring Boot. So it is nothing but Spring Cloud and Netflix OSS. So we will be working extensively in that. So these are few components. While going through the slide, I will explain what each component is for. So what is a microservice? Any idea actually with the microservices? You are all working people, and I'm happy to see a few people with whom I have interacted in Facebook. I can see them here. So really happy to have a webinar session with you. Thanks for joining. So any idea like why we are going in for microservices? Okay, so you all are working in monolithic architecture, and I have heard that few people are working in Spring Boot with microservices. So what are the disadvantages of a microservice or a monolithic architecture? It has got a large code base. So whenever you are adding more and more functionality, it is done on the same application, and the whole application itself is deployed as a var. Yes. Okay. So the whole application, the one single application is deployed as a server. And whenever you are making any changes, again, you need to redeploy the whole application. So this also, it is happening that we are going in for more deployment. And in this case, the application here, the components are tightly coupled. You all know that because of in a monolithic architecture, all the components are tightly coupled. And there is also a problem with cross-functionality services. You will be having a separate UI. You are having a middleware. And of course, you are having a database. Everything put together is deployed as a single WAR file. So these are few disadvantages. So what exactly is microservice? Why should I go in for microservice? See, when people were working, especially with Netflix, they were having a problem of scalability. When the code base was increasing, there were challenges in deployment. So they came up with this Netflix OSS, which is nothing but a set of frameworks and libraries. They came up with this architectural style. What is this microservice? It is nothing but you are having a your application, you are converting or you are decomposing your application into many services, into a suite of small services. Suppose say if it is an online application, so you all know if it is an online e-commerce application, what are the functionalities that you can think about? You can think about the product, you can think about the buyer, you can think about the details. I mean, I'm talking about the modules, seller, then billing, then inventory, order, wish list. So there are specific functionalities. Instead of creating them as modules and deploying them as a one single WAR file, we are going in for individual services. The advantage of microservice over monolithic is they are loosely coupled services. And in case of monolithic, you are going to use only the same language for overall, like for all the modules. But in case of microservice, I can create a product in Node.js. I can work buyer in Groovy. I can use Java for working with the seller. So I can create it in any language and any database. So it is nothing but a collection of loosely coupled services. And how they are how they are going to work with each other as REST APIs or RPC, remote procedure calls. So Spring supports REST API. So because of that only you are using Spring Boot, which is supporting microservices. You don't have to use Java. You can use Kotlin. You can use Groovy. Or for developing a service, you can also use Node.js. So in case of a monolithic application, the whole application is going to run in one single process with one database. Of course, you can do horizontal scaling in case of monolithic architecture. In case of microservice, one second, someone is joining. Okay. What is PCF? PCF is nothing but Pivotal Cloud Foundry. Okay, so when you say Pivotal Cloud Foundry, where will you deploy your application? Usually when we show the example in corporates, we deploy it in our own system and we just show the examples. But in corporates, certain places, they say that they don't have the accessibility. So we create an account in Pivotal Cloud Foundry. There we will deploy the server. So that and rest of the services will be added to that service. I hope you can understand. I will create a service registry in Pivotal Cloud Foundry and I will add my services to that Pivotal Cloud Foundry. So when we are working in a team, it was easier for us to connect to it. Okay. Netflix, whatever Netflix you are seeing is the same Netflix company here. They had the problem of streaming their videos in a monolithic architecture. They found it was very slow. The application itself was very slow and there was issues in streaming. Whenever they are changing any functionality, they have to redeploy their application again. The code base was going bigger and bigger. To avoid that, they came with this particular architectural style called as microservice. Microservice is nothing here. Like, assume that you are conducting a big event in your office. What you do, it is not that one single person is going to do everything. You divide into groups. Say, transport, this group will take care of the transport. This group will take care of the chief guest. This group will take care of the decoration part. So you divide that services and you collaborate, right? The same thing is done in case of microservice. In case of microservice, how we tell is like, it is nothing but individual services. So this is a simple online application. In case of an online application, you have an order management, product management, inventory, delivery, everything is separate service. What exactly is the meaning of a separate service? So this is how it will look like. In a monolithic architecture, this is my UI, right? And the middleware, this is the middleware part, and then I'm having the database, so this is the DAO part, and this is the database which I'm having. So the whole application itself is deployed as a VAR or an EAR, and whenever and there is always a problem with the UI collaboration between the UI and the middleware. But in case of a microservice, I have got multiple functionalities. I am dividing each functionality into individual service. So in this case, I'm having an order management. This is inventory management. And this is user management. So there are scenarios wherein you can either have your own database or you can combine and combine your database with other people. Is this clear? Okay, so now next, is any doubt?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so this is these are few things about microservices. And what is the difference between a monolithic and microservice? In case of monolithic, they are tightly coupled modules. They are deployed as a single one. These are loosely coupled individual services. In case of monolithic, they are again, as I told you, they are combined as one unit. Here also, when you say a microservice, they are having their own. We don't use an UI, but if you want an UI, their UI, their own their own middleware part, their own database. Again, same way, middleware part and the database. In case of microservice, each microservice talk to each other using REST API calls. So I hope you all know about Spring Boot. In my course, like initially, I will give an introduction about Spring Boot, how to create a REST API using Spring Boot, and how to work with Spring Data JPA. Once we have created a solid service, then we will be creating other service supporting services, and we'll be working with that. So this is the difference. So this is how it will look like. See, actually, the whole application is nothing but a microservice. So I don't bother about the shopping cart API. This part is my microservice. How the services will talk to each other? In case of a monolithic architecture, it is only one single var file. Each module can talk to each other by using objects. You use auto wiring and all the other concepts. In this case, how they talk to each other? Because everything is a REST API, you can make REST API calls. How actually order will know about catalog, or how user will know about order? It is done with the help of a service registry. So all the services will register themselves in a service registry, and if they want to connect to any other service, they will check in the service registry and they will get it. I don't know, like people, if you are from Java background, you would have heard about RMI. Remote method invocation, which is a very, very old concept, wherein we will be having an RMA registry. And whenever I am creating some application, I will put my application in my RMA registry so that others can use it. Similar to that, here we are having a proper service registry. So what are the real-time examples of microservices which companies are using? Netflix. So Netflix only, these guys, they came with this OSS, which is what actually now an online... One second, someone is joining. Let me So Netflix OSS, they are nothing but set of frameworks and libraries. So these are few companies which are using it. And as I told, in your company, you might be having your own way of doing it. But here, Netflix is the few corporates are replicating the frameworks and libraries similar to Netflix. What are the advantages of microservices? It is modular in nature. And what you learn in the nature, in the sense, like each service is independent. This is not dependent on the other service. So there might be a question which can be asked. So assume that I am having a book service and I am having an order service. Of course, order depends on books. So order is making a call to book. What about the book model? Whatever book model you are having here should be replicated in this. People who have worked in REST API in Spring, you might be knowing it. So the model classes should be replicated in all the services. That is mandatory. So the whole thing combined is going to be one big application. But internally, if you see that, they are individual services. So they are modular in nature. Each service is having, see, if it's again going with the concept of single responsibility principle, which is a design principle in Java. So you know that. So each service is going to take care of a particular functionality. How will you decide that, how to divide your application based on the functionality? So for that, we will be learning about the different design patterns in microservices. And the development and deployment, as I told you, each service has to be developed separately. They will be deployed separately. This can be done in Groovy. This can be done in Java. And they will be deployed as REST APIs. How they talk to each other in the form of JSON. And one more thing, what should be the size of a microservice? Few people, you would have heard about this concept, two pizza rule. What is the meaning of it? The team size should be in such a way that they can be fed by two large pizzas. If you need more pizzas than that, it means that your size of your team is big. That is the meaning. And the applications are loosely coupled. Of course, order doesn't have to bother about book. Book doesn't have to bother about order. They are all loosely coupled application. They talk to each other in the form of JSON. They are independently scalable. The name itself says, now in case of order, I want to add some more functionalities. That is what is the wish list. If I want to add few more functionalities without disturbing the other service, I can add it in my order service. So it is very faster because it is a simple thing. And improved fault isolation. This is a very important point. Means if your application, in case of a monolithic application, this is a one big application. When a request comes in, if something goes wrong, or if the number of requests are more, of course you would have done horizontal scaling behind a load balancer. But if something goes wrong, the whole application will crash. But in case of microservice, what we will do is we also have a load balancer. We would have deployed and we will be having multiple microservices, and it is a single point of failure. Say for example, I'm having A talking to B, B talking to C. And again, if any of this particular microservice fails, it is easy for me to identify the point of fault, and it is easy for me to connect compared to a monolithic application, right? Okay. And technology diversity, already I have told, it can be developed and deployed in any technology stack. Now, now assume that you have decided to create and work with microservices. In that scenario, what are the things you have to consider? So first thing is, you have to consider the design pattern. What are the design patterns that are available in your microservice? Based on the design pattern, you are going to decompose your application into multiple services. And then you will have to decide on the service registry. You have got Eureka, you have got console, and in certain corporates, they have their own service registry. The next is, you are going to create services. For creating the services, you can use any language, and you are going to create them as REST APIs. And of course, few places they are using it as RPCs also. But in our case, we are working with REST APIs. Next is fault tolerance. So how to handle fault tolerance? Fault tolerance in the sense, we have to identify the fault, and the exception or whatever is happening has to be thrown to the previous layer. So for that, this is mandatory. In case of Netflix, it is nothing but Hystrix. And now if I want to monitor my application, like how many requests are coming into my application, what is happening to a particular method, how to do that, Hystrix support with this dashboard. If the number of requests goes beyond a particular level, I need to break the circuit. So for that, we have got something called a circuit breaker. So this also has to be considered when you are working with microservices. Then there is a gateway API. Whatever request comes in from a mobile application, from a desktop application, from a laptop. So I need a gateway API, which is nothing but Zool. With Zool, you will be doing routing, you will be doing filtering, and also it acts as a gateway API. So the front end is totally hidden, and this is my application which is deployed to my service registry. Then I have a load balancer. So Zool is a server side load balancer, and of course we have something called as Ribbon. Ribbon is a client side load balancer. Okay, and the last one is declarative client. See, whenever you want to work with REST API, you know you would have used what is that, like if you want to consume a REST API, you use REST template, right? With the help of REST template, you have to know the URI to call it. But there is something called as Feen. Feen is a HTTP client which will help me to declaratively create it. I have got some question, I think. Okay, client side load balancer. How actually a client side load balancer works, I'll just tell you. See, I will just show you the application so that it is easier for you to. Okay, so whatever I have told, it is over here. So Netflix is it's a framework plus library. It is used for working with microservice architecture. It has got containers, libraries and services, Eureka, Hystrix fault tolerance, gateway API, Ribbon and Feen. So what is the purpose of Ribbon? I will just tell you. For that, we need to see this application. This kind of application is what we are going to create. So now I have many services. So you can see service one, service two, service three. So creating a REST API, you all guys know. To this REST API, you will be attaching few things, Ribbon, Feen, Hystrix. Okay, how Ribbon is going to work, I will just tell you. Say for example, a API call is coming to Zool. Now I have service one. So this service one, I will deploy in many servers. Okay, so it assume that it is available in 81, 82, 83. Now, and I will attach Ribbon to it. Okay, so the service, that particular service is deployed in multiple ports, and I will attach Ribbon to it. So this Ribbon, what it will do is, it has got its own way of identifying. So it is going to do the load balancing. Based on the request, it will check which of that particular service is not being consumed. So it will go and connect to that particular service. The same service is being deployed in multiple places. Ribbon behaves like a load balancer. So it has got its own way of identifying. So you can just have a look here. So it is having round robin rule, weighted response time rule, availability filtering rule. So I have the same service deployed in four places. So it will use round robin. I don't have to tell what exactly it is. Availability filtering rule means when the request is coming in, it will check which of the port number is free and available. So it is going to take that particular service, right? And weighted response rule, if any of the port number is going to take more time to return the response, it will not consider that particular port number to take over the service. So I hope you are clear. So I have a load balancer. So Ribbon is my load balancer. When a request is coming in, Ribbon has to choose from any of these ports, the same service. Now there are three rules. So based on the rule, it will take it. So by default, it will take round robin rule. If you want to go in for cert any other way, you can just select it. And one more thing is, like if a particular port number or if a particular server is getting dropped off again and again because of some fault, Ribbon will not consider that particular server. So these are few things that we will be discussing while working with these concepts. So here, see, this is what I was telling. So here I have an API gateway. So these are few services and what is the database. And all these are connected to Eureka service registry. Together with that, you will also learn about the configuration. What is the meaning of configuration? You guys know that you don't keep all the configuration in one particular application. You will have in a centralized place. That centralized place is nothing but Spring Cloud Config. All the configuration details related to the database will be available there. So this is the Zool, this is the whole application. So how you create or how we will be working, that is what I'm just showing. So here I have got few services. They are all connected to the service registry. I have connected it. And they are not connected to the outside world. Zool, through Zool API gateway only, they are connected to the outside world. This client can be an Angular application, or it can be a Spring MVC application, or React, or any other front-end application. So I hope this is this part is clear. So I will just show you a small part which I have done. So this is, you can just have a look. So this is how we usually do. So the first thing is you create a service, Eureka server. So once you create a Eureka server, the Eureka server, for that we will be using application.yaml file. So this is my application.yaml file. Here I have given where exactly my server is. It is in the local host. Whether this server has to register itself, false. So we have given those details. And now you can just see, this is my Eureka server in which I have deployed one book service application. You can see the book service application. This book service is nothing but a REST API which I have created. And you have to give all the details related to that here. So this is not actually an error. This is because of Lombok. I hope you would have heard about Lombok, right? It which will help you to create getter and setter methods. That was the reason. And here I have used Spring Data JPA. I think I cannot go long beyond this point because the timing duration is getting over. So here you can see, this is my application.yaml file. So here, wherein the same thing what you have worked with Spring Data JPA, you are just going to create a Spring Data JPA. The only thing that differs over here is this. You are registering yourself to Eureka client service URL. Together with the Spring Boot application, whatever you are adding, just a second, I'll just do, where is that here? The main class. Book service. Yeah, here. So you are making this as a discovery client. So similar to this, whenever you are going, you will be adding more and more components. So that way we'll be working so that it is in a continuous flow. So how to work with Hystrix, how to add ribbon, how they are interconnected. A connected to B, B connected to C. This way only the whole series of our course will go. So technically speaking, you'll be creating an end-to-end application. In case of the front end, either you can use Postman, or we can go in for, if you are not happy to work with Angular, we can create a Spring MVC through Zool Gateway API. You are going to connect to a microservice ecosystem. So in this case, I have worked with book application. So these two errors, whatever you are seeing, they are because of Lombok. And Lombok I have not added to it. So so I have told what is being covered. Any questions from your side? The duration is less, so any questions? Hello? You can just message if you are having any questions or anything in the chat window.
Hi.
Yeah, hi. Yeah.
Actually, this all those terms are very new. It is time taking to understand, like all those, like Netflix, Zool, API, everything. You are going fast. So,
sorry, actually, may I know your good name?
Revati.
Yeah. See, basically, like I'll be going step by step only. So the idea over here is like, I just want to share whatever we will be teaching in this particular course. This course is basically for 30 hours. So everything we will be doing one by one application, understanding the concept, and then only we will be moving on. I wanted to give a heads up on these topics. So we will be starting with Spring Boot, and then only we will be moving towards the next topic. So you don't have to bother about it. here why I was specific is like, say I just want to show you, I didn't want to say what is microservice and say that the demo is completed. I wanted to tell you what are the components that you will be seeing. So initially it will be like Greek and Latin only, but when you start working, it will be really very interesting. You will be understanding the flow, how exactly it is happening. See, this is one such application is what I have created. So this is what we do. And I have also created an application for Upwork. So like how a microservice connects. So you don't have to bother about it. I am just talking about the topics that will be covered in the session. Anything else? Okay. Like, and I am planning to start this session from next week. Anybody interested? Anybody wants to know more on this?
Yes, I am interested.
You are Revathi, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So we will connect with you. Like, we'll connect with you, and he will give the details. I am planning to start from next week. If you guys are interested, okay, we will take it a call. And don't worry, I went fast because I was getting.